So let me introduce our next lecturer, Professor Rodam Narasimha. He obtained his master's degree by research at the Indian Institute of Science as a student of Satish Dhawan, and PhD at Caltech with Hassan Liebman. He is currently at the Jawaharlal Nehru Center for Advanced Science Research at Bangalore. His work has been concerned chiefly with turbulent shear flows, transition, linearization, memory of free shear flows, the bursting phenomenon that links to outer flow in boundary layer, and most recently has spent most of his professional life most recently with convective boundary layers in the atmosphere and the cumulus cloud flows in the laboratory. He has spent most of his professional life at Indian Institute of Science, and headed the National Aerospace Laboratories for 9 years. He is a fellow of Royal Society, foreign associate of the U.S. National Academy of Engineering and of Science, and was president of the Indian Academy of Science during 1992 to 1994. And he's going to give us a lecture on Satish Dhawan.
Thank you. Well, I must first of all thank the editors of this volume, A Voyage Through Turbulence, and asking me to write about that part of the voyage which started in India some 50 years ago, and the organizers of this meeting for inviting me to come here and speak about Satish Dhawan. I'm conscious of the fact that this presentation I make about Satish Dhawan is in some sense going to be different from that of the others here for two reasons. First, this is the only one here representing an area outside Europe and America. The editors of the volume and I tried to get some other contributions from other parts of the world, but did not really succeed for whatever reason. The voyage that the title of the book talks about can be, whatever has happened in India in turbulent flow research can be traced to the early 1950s, and in fact can be traced to the arrival of Satish Dhawan after his PhD from Caltech. Now, fluid dynamics research in India came very late, and so did any research in engineering science. So in some sense, all of this happened together. In Bangalore at the Indian Institute of Science, we can date it to around the 1950s. And if you look at why it happened at that time, it had to do with the initiatives that Indian leaders took soon after the end of British rule in 1947. Jawaharlal Nehru was the Prime Minister at the time. I work in a center which is named after him. And he believed that the salvation of India lay in science and technology. Some of you will know that he actually did a BA in Cambridge in natural science before he became a lawyer and before he became a politician. He used to say, even after he became the Prime Minister of the country, when he and some of his scientific collaborators, so to speak, started on a spree of setting up new institutions in India, he would go to one of these labs and say, I'd much rather be director of this scientific laboratory than the Prime Minister of India. But unfortunately, I'm incompetent to be the director. So he had this great faith in science and engineering, and therefore took a very large number of initiatives at that time. And Satish Dhawan has to be seen in the light of that new initiative that was taken in India in the late 40s and through the 50s. Now, it's not that there was no science in India before then, or no engineering. As a matter of fact, it comes as a surprise to most people, including most Indians, that the first Indian fellow of the Royal Society, elected to the Royal Society, was an engineer. And that was actually in the 1820s, believe it or not. A shipbuilder in Bombay, Karsetji Wadia was his name, built such fine ships for the East India Company and kept pace with the industrial revolution that was going on in Britain, so that he got steam engines there. He went there and said, this is the kind of engine I want, and so on. That the British were very surprised, and he was the first Indian to be elected to the Royal Society. The second one had to wait for almost 100 years, and that was Ramanujan, who was a mathematician. But in the first half of the 20th century, physics, mathematics grew in India very rapidly. There are the names of, I mentioned Ramanujan. There was C.V. Raman, who won the Nobel Prize. There was J.C. Bose, who actually made the first microwave devices in the world in the 1890s. Satyendranath Bose, whose name many of you will have heard, the man who with Einstein is associated with Bose-Einstein statistics, and many others. But the tradition that, the legacy that you might have expected from Karsetji's shipbuilding enterprise didn't last. It's a very interesting question about why any kind of engineering development disappeared from India for a long time. So when it came back in the 1940s and 50s, it is interesting that the inspiration for this actually started with aeronautics. And the reason was the Second World War. Bangalore was chosen as the base, in particular the maintenance and repair base, for the Southeast Asia Command in the Pacific. And therefore, an industry was set up with the active cooperation of a very far-seeing chief minister that the state of Mysore had at that time. And in the early 1940s, a company called Hindustan Aircraft was set up. And a leading role in that company was played by Americans. And at the end of the war, one of the Americans who ran it said, we need many more people in aeronautics in India, so I'm going to give scholarships so that we can train Indians in the United States in aeronautics. So a large number of the first batch of Indians who learned aeronautics went actually to the United States. So once the aeronautics department was started, 2 years later, the Indian Institute of Science decided to start a department of aeronautics. And the first man they got to head the department was an Indian student of Ludwig Prandtl. He didn't appear in Bodhan Schatz's list. A man named Ghatge, Vishnu Madhav Ghatge. He sat there for 2 years and went on to move to industry. And after a short interval was succeeded by Oscar Titian, as Srinivasan mentioned this morning. So when I joined the Institute of Science in 1953, it was Titian who was the head of the department. And I took my first course in fluid mechanics from him. It might well have been the first course taught in modern fluid dynamics in India. Well, Titian left in 1954-55. And in 1951, Satish Dhawan had come back to India after spending 4 years in the United States, where he obtained a master's degree and a PhD. And I want to start, let's see. So when I joined the institute, this is what he looked like. He was at that time, he joined in 1951, I joined in 1953. So he'd just been there for 2 years. Young man, handsome, still single, and a very singular presence on the campus of the Indian Institute of Science. He was handsome. He was a star among the students. He brought Californian informality to the campus. He came to the department in a very sporty red MG, jumped out of it, ran up the stairs. All these things were some things which people, professors in the Institute of Science, normally didn't do. At the early age of, well, in the 1950s, as I said, 54, 55, when Titians left, Dhawan took over as the head of the department. Dhawan's career sort of splits into three or four phases, and I want to show you a few pictures of Dhawan later on. In the 1970s, well, in 1962 actually, in 1962 he became director of the Indian Institute of Science, and in the 1970s, 1971, 72, he became chief of the Indian Space Program. He held both positions till the 1980s, and then retired in 1982, and by that stage he had become the wise engineer, the elder statesman of Indian science in general and Indian technology in particular. He was a very unusual man, and I'd like to say a few words about what determined his career in science. He was born in 1920 in Srinagar, the capital of Kashmir in India. But actually his father, he came from a family of professionals. There were already doctors, lawyers, teachers and so on. And his father was a judge, a very respected judge in Punjab. And as happened to many people who served the Indian services at that time, he used to be shifted from one place to another. This wasn't good for the children's education. So a lot of the early education of Satish took place through tutors at home. But the father himself was transferred all around. And that area, to people who know India, is really Kipling land. It was the kind of thing that Kipling wrote about, the northwestern frontier. You know, the kind of area which still is to some extent wild in that part of India and Pakistan. I remember that Dhawan, for quite some time, used to tell us stories about his days in the northwestern frontier. One of the famous ones, which circulated all through Caltech as where he went as a student and continued in India after he came back, was this. He would talk about his encounters with camel drivers, for example. And he said, in Dera Ismail Khan, Dera Ismail Khan is a romantic name in India as well as elsewhere. It's one of those outposts in the northwestern frontier. I met this camel driver and I say, hey, what do you call your camel? And he would say, Greta Garbo. and this was the kind of stories that he was full of as he talked about the northwest frontier. He had a very unusual education. He had a BA in physics and mathematics from Punjab University, an MA in English literature. So I used to ask him, now how come you took an MA in English literature after a BA in physics and mathematics? He said, oh, I got more time for playing tennis if I took literature, he said. But then he went on to do an honors in mechanical engineering as well. And I think at that time he found what it was that he wanted to do. He spent a year in Bangalore in the aircraft industry after that. That was his first exposure to aircraft. And then went to the United States on one of these scholarships. First went to Minnesota and then to Caltech, worked with Liebman, got his PhD and returned in 1951 to the Indian Institute of Science. You've seen his picture at that time. So that was his career. When he came to India in 1951, he was a senior scientific officer. That's why he was still not a faculty member. A year later, he became a faculty member, was an assistant professor, and then rose very rapidly through the system, headed the department in 1955. In 1963, at the age of 42, he became director of the Indian Institute of Science. That was unusually early for somebody in India especially. Then in 1972, he became chairman of the Indian Space Research Organization. He held a formal administrative position in the government. He was secretary to the government. But he insisted that he should continue as the director of the Indian Institute of Science. So he continued a career in academia, even as he had this formal position in government. He retired from there in 1981. Continued for some years his involvement with space, and as I said, became an elder statesman of the scientific community in India. He married in 1956 and has three children. I'll come to that later on. So here is his advisor on the left, Hans Liebmann, who I think had a considerable influence on Dhawan. And I think that something seemed to agree with Dhawan very well when he went to Caltech. As I said, it had partly to do with the informality, partly to do with the fact that the kind of research done in Galsett was a mixture of science and engineering. He liked to be in contact with the industry, but at the same time, he liked to do basic research. So that's Liebmann. And on the other side is Liebmann in an Indian silk shawl. When Dhawan passed away, Liebmann reminisced about the time that Dhawan spent at Galsett as a student. And here is what he said. He said some other things too. He talks about bifurcation points in one's life. And one of these bifurcations in 1946 was when he met Satish Dhawan. I wrote about the occasion a number of years ago in a memoir. And what it says is this. Liebmann had an Indian student earlier, and he'd been very unhappy with him because that student was not willing to do any real physical laboratory work. And so he said, no more Indians. And then Satish Dhawan went there as a student. And when Dr. Sekla, who used to look after admissions, said, there's an Indian student here, you might want to meet him. No, he said, no, I don't want any more Indian students. So he told him, no, this one is different. And in fact, he met him, and it changed his view about Indians in general, India, and of course, in particular, Satish Dhawan. And then he said, in 2002, when Satish Dhawan, whose personality and friendship had an important and lasting effect on me and my understanding of India. Okay. So both of them had great influence on each other. Dhawan was an extraordinarily popular man. Here he is with Anatole Roshko, who was more or less his contemporary there. They got their degrees around the same time, and friends for the rest of their lives. Dhawan made an extraordinary impression there because, first of all, he was very good with his fingers and his hands. He was an excellent experimentalist. He was ingenious in the way that he set up his equipment, made instruments. And so they saw in him a part of the tradition of the ingenious Yankee. At the same time, he was in other ways very Indian. He would quote Shakespeare because of his degree in literature. And he could tell stories about the Northwestern frontier. And so they were actually very taken by him. His scientific work divides into three or four phases. First were the Caltech years themselves. One other thing that Liebmann said was that when Dhawan began working in the lab, the people at that time included Roshko, Coles, and the end of, I think, Stanley Carson's presence there. Kármán was still there at that time. And he said that Satish Dhawan sort of became, first of all, immediately accepted, a great friend, and secondly, informally, almost the leader of that group, of that laboratory. And he said he had an extraordinary judgment about scientific problems and human relations, and that's what really made him very different. So this is the first study that he made when he was at Caltech. It's described in an NACA report which came in 1951. It had to do with shock boundary layer interaction. There's that well-known photograph on the right, which has appeared in many books, including Stisting's book, showing what happens when a shock wave hits, in this particular case, a curved surface, an aerofoil, and that pressure distribution. A set of famous measurements where they had a shock hitting a flat plate and measured the pressure distribution. with that strong upstream influence that you see there. Shorter when the boundary layer is turbulent, and much longer, almost 50 boundary layer thicknesses, when the boundary layer is laminar. It's interesting to read that report because it says it may seem illogical to study shock boundary layer interaction now because we don't understand supersonic boundary layers. And people will ask, why are you doing shock boundary layer interactions when you don't understand the shock supersonic boundary layer yet? However, they give an argument saying that it's important and that there's some phenomena which stand out. And of course, this strong upstream influence then, of course, was studied quite extensively, and various theoretical models have been made as well. Lighthill and others contributed to it. And earlier, some work had been done by Akaret in Aachen. But I think that between the work that Liebmann did on transonic flows, Akaret and supersonic flows, and this study by Liebmann, Rashko, and Dhawan, the basic phenomenon got to be documented very well. What he did for his thesis was a direct measurement of the skin friction on a flat surface, on a flat plate. Dhawan used to say that the reason that they did this was that Kaman would ask them, how come people do all these things in boundary layers, but there is no direct measurement of the skin friction on a flat plate yet? At that time, the major reason given for why, for the scientific importance of measuring the skin friction directly, was that it did not assume the validity of boundary layer theory. It may come as a surprise to us now, but at that time, I think it had not yet been realized that boundary layer theory is, in some sense, a valid leading term in an asymptotic expansion of the solution of the Navier-Stokes equations. There was still a little bit of that view that it was a very clever and surprisingly successful engineering approximation. So it was then decided, Liebmann and Dhawan decided that they would actually make those measurements. And Dhawan, characteristically for him, made this very small instrument. I think it was made with great care. It used modern methods. It used a variable reluctance transformer for making measurements on a very small floating element. Let's see, is there a pointer here? Yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm. There's a small floating element there. And with the flow there, that moves this thing in this variable reluctance transformer, sends a signal. So that is actually calibrated in situ. Differential transformers. This one is with the differential transformer. Could adjust the screw. And he spent a lot of time trying to make sure that the drag on that little element was the same as what you would have on the rest of the surface, that the gaps did not influence it, there was no crossflow across the gaps, and so on. And at the end, came up with these measurements. This is the way that it appears in that report, which actually is dated 1953. The work was done in 1951. Well, laminar boundary layers, there's blastias, agrees very well. And there's turbulent boundary layers here. The range of Reynolds numbers is not very large. And there's an expression due to Kaman, which is set there, and it seems to agree very well. But Dhawan, once again, it's a characteristic of the way he did research. He was very cautious about interpreting this result. He found that the constants on that line, the line called Kaman, were not the constants that Kaman gave. Constants had to be changed. And so he says, well, it looks good there, but I'm still not sure that you can say that Kaman's theory is right because the numbers in that expression are different. The same diagram appeared in Schlichting's book, but this time comparing the turbulent data with Prandtl. Well, that seems to agree well too. But that was a power law. Well, there was this thing between power loss and log loss. And that was an early reflection of that continuing argument. Both of them agreed well over that range, not surprisingly from our present understanding of what happens. But the interesting thing there was that Dhawan also made some measurements in supersonic force and some measurements during transition. He did have skin friction measurements made during transition, but not on a single plate as the Reynolds number was varied, but at a given point as the flow conditions were altered, rather than one along the streamwise distance. So he had to do with different flow Reynolds numbers as these experiments were made. And I think that was the first time that he did something on transition. And I think this also was something on his mind when he came to Bangalore. After Dhawan left, the work was continued by Donald Coles. He made a very similar instrument to measure the skin friction. And he did it in supersonic flows. And he collected, many of you who know Don Coles will know, he collected whatever data was available on skin friction measurements at that time, and then plotted the direct skin friction measurements in this paper of his, which appeared in ZAMP, called The Problem of the Turbulent Boundary Layer. Now, this is a diagram which goes across two pages of that paper. And you can see that the measurements here cover four decades in the Reynolds number. And for four decades in the Reynolds number, all made by three different people, the trend seems very clear. And the scatter is small. This surprised Don Coles. And this is what he said in the paper. There's a single curve over the whole range of Reynolds numbers from 2 into 10 to the 5 to 4 into 10 to the 8. With a scatter so small as to be almost unprecedented in boundary layer research. And then he said, in fact, it may be admitted. Don Coles is not a man who usually admits things very easily. So it may be admitted, he said, that the present re-examination of the turbulent boundary layer problem was to a large extent inspired by the remarkable consistency of these local skin friction data. Well, he did that, and he almost left immediately actually he didn't submit his thesis before he left, because the rules of the government about coming back were very strict. He had a draft and left it with his advisor, who submitted it a little bit later on. When he came back to Bangalore, I actually first was doing a master's by instruction at that time called the diploma of the institute. But I started doing a little research with Dhawan. I helped them set up tunnels and calibrate them, made some boundary layer measurements and so on. And then at the end of the 2-year course, he asked me, well, why don't you join research? And that was something which I very much liked. I was a little too hesitant to ask him till then. And so we spent some time doing, I spent 2 years studying transition on flat plates. And I want to say something about what we did at the time. This was inspired by Emmons' theory. That picture is taken from Emmons' paper in 1951. When Dhawan made those direct skin friction measurements, he said, it looks as if the flow is intermittent. Dryden had found that some time ago, Liebman found that some years ago, and that's what Emmons is talking about. Maybe it's all the same thing. So when I joined, the first thing I did was to read Emmons. And this diagram is taken from Emmons' well-known paper, where he made the suggestion that transition took place through these turbulent spots. And the idea was radical at that time, or seemed radical, because the flow was laminar both upstream and downstream of the spot. So there was an island of turbulence, but it was surrounded by a laminar sea. Other ideas at that time, often more favored, said that laminar and turbulent flow are separated by a jagged line, a front, which separates turbulent flow downstream from laminar flow upstream. Emmons went on to make a theory for the fraction of time that the flow would be turbulent if it was due to spots like this. Spots which, in his mind, were born all over the surface, spread linearly, where that's shown there, along cones. And if there were a roughness, there would be a permanent wedge, which is a turbulent region like that. Otherwise, there would be a source here, a spot would be born, and it would sweep an area, keep growing, as it propagated downstream. And Emmons made a theory for connecting the rate of formation of spots with the fraction of time that the flow was turbulent at any point on the surface. The formation rate was called g of x. It depended on x. This is a two-dimensional flat plate flow. Downstream here, time y, the projection of this propagation cone on the xy plane, on the flat plate, is the diagram that you saw before. And Emmons went ahead to relate g of x to that variation of the intermittency. Here is the curve that he drew. And I put it in a different form, in a different expression. This is the same result as Emmons. But it's good to see that what it implied was that the distribution was universal with respect to x over x bar. X bar is the place where you have 50% of the time laminar flow and 50% of the time turbulent flow. Now, for Emmons, it's a detailed discussion about where spots will be born. There was one idea that the likelihood of spots being born as you go downstream must be higher because the flow is more unstable. But another idea which said, no, as you go further far downstream, it shouldn't be because the flow is getting to be turbulent in any case. So it discusses the pros and cons and even considers what might happen if spots were born only after a certain distance. But eventually he settles for x to the m. I always wondered why he did that. And I think he was at that time very largely influenced by the discovery of what's known as transverse contamination. If you have a flat plate in a wind tunnel, there's a wedge which comes from where the plate intersects the tunnel, and that seems to start right from the leading edge. So the idea that spots will come all over the place seemed logical. So he eventually plumped for an expression which depended on M. So this is the kind of curve that he had. And this gives you spot formation rates in the normalization that seems natural to the way Emmons did it. And those numbers varied from 10 to the minus 20 to 10 to the minus 14. Mind you, microscopic. And when I first saw that, I mean, surprising. There must be other scales. Those are not the right scales for the problem. But anyway, that's the way that it was. And he also obtained local skin friction coefficients. And he said, we need a great deal more data on local skin friction coefficients before we can decide what's happening. That, of course, was what Dhawan was doing on the other coast in the United States at the same time. And in fact, Dhawan had some transitional data, as I mentioned to you. This shows the way that the local skin friction coefficient varies with the Reynolds number. You take Emmons's model. That was the data available at that time. Then in 1955, Schubauer and Klebanoff made what I consider to be brilliant experiments on this whole business of the Emmons spot. They actually triggered artificial spots with a spark and could measure the shape of the spot, that island of turbulence. They could measure its profile along the normal. So you can see that that was the shape of the spot, sort of heart-shaped. These were the traces of the velocity. So when the spark is made, that's when the spark is made. Time is this way. It takes that much time before the spot reaches the place where you have the probe, and that's turbulent flow. And then it slowly tapers off into laminar flow again. And they could map the shape of the spot on the surface, its projection on the surface, and its shape across the central section in X and Y. They traveled at constant fractions of the free stream velocity. They spread at this angle, at least when there was no pressure gradient. So virtually every assumption in Emmons's theory seemed to be confirmed by these experiments. They also found this calming effect, another set of traces. That's what they look like, calming here. You could in fact make spots, and if you made a spot, it would actually suppress the oscillations in the flow. It would be turbulent there, but these oscillations would be suppressed. You can see here too. It would be calm for a long time. After a spot passed, the flow was actually stabler for some time and made sure that there was no other spot coming up immediately. So there were all these discoveries. And they also measured this intermittency distribution. The intermittency distribution, they fitted a Gaussian to this. And one thing that Dhawan and I discussed a great deal was why he was fitting a Gaussian, because he seemed to have shown that all the assumptions made in the Emmons theory were correct. There were spots, they traveled linearly, their velocities were proportional to the free stream velocity and so on. And after some false starts, we found that it had in fact to do with that same GX. This shows that the measurements that we had at that time, two measurements we made at that time, wouldn't scale with X over X bar. And in fact, even this measurement that we had here, if you tried to coincide the point where intermittency is half, it should be about there, and use Emmons's expression, here the intermittency would be 34%. Obviously, the difference was just too large. So you had to abandon that assumption. And the one that actually worked was to say that most spots would actually be born around a certain given distance from the leading edge. You can say that that marks the onset of transition if you want, a place like XT. Of course, not all of them would be born there. They would be born in a little belt around it. And but it was not worthwhile making that an additional dimension in the problem. And so if you do that, then in fact, all the things collapse. This was the tunnel where these things were made. This was another tunnel which was built by Dhawan, and some traces here, and the expression for the intermittency becomes this. And here were the measurements made by Schubauer and Klebanov, and by then we had a lot of data of our own. They all seemed to collapse on this curve. So that led to a description of what happens during the transition. As I said earlier, Dhawan was very conscious, and he wanted very much that we should try what would happen if spots were born over a much longer belt, much wider belt. And here are calculations made with different widths. If spots were born according to this Gaussian, centered at that point, what would the intermittency distribution be? And we found that it was not terribly sensitive, but the best results were obtained with very narrow bands. And a large number of consequences which followed. I will not really go into them in detail, but including this particular one, which is especially interesting, which is about the local skin friction. If the spots are born at some distance downstream of the leading edge, then you can show easily that if you plot the local skin friction government, it will always overshoot the fully turbulent curve before it settles down to it. And this, in fact, was found by Don Coles in the measurements that he made after Dhawan had left. And those overshoots, therefore, sort of confirmed the general validity of the view that we had. Well, Now, why did Dhawan start this on transition? Well, as I said, even when he was at Caltech, there had been these transitional measurements that he had made, and he was familiar with MLC's theory. But he did it because of an Indian reason, and that was very important for him. That's the way that his mind worked. The industry at that time was trying to design a fighter aircraft called the HF-24. And it had to be tested in a relatively small tunnel at the Indian Institute of Science at that time. The Reynolds numbers were all in the very inconvenient range where transition occurs. So in the range of 10 to the 5 to 10 to the 6, and on the model and on the wings, transition was a major factor. So he said, we should understand transition, and therefore that's how this project was started, to help industry on the face of it. But once it was started and it gave some interesting results, it became a research problem on its own. Again and again, Dhawan sought to look at basic problems which emerged from the real problems that industry was facing at that time. And in my article there, a whole series of such problems are actually set down. Well, after that, he had many students who worked with him and who got degrees. I'll have a list of them at the end. But he hardly published anything after this piece of work. In 1962, when he became the director of the institute, he turned his attention to transforming the institute, which he very successfully did. And then another 10 years later, he became head of the space program. And therefore, although he had research students working with him even when he was the director, by the time he became the head of the space program, active academic work was not something that he had any time for. But he always kept his contacts with young faculty and young students throughout his professional career. This is typical of him. Here he is with young professional colleagues and students. I must tell you that the glass here which he's holding in his hand does not contain alcohol. And that's the joke that he's cutting. Everybody else was taking alcohol, but he was not. It was not that he had any objection to taking alcohol, but he had actually by that time decided to abandon that. But you know, he's a man of with a great sense of humor, and had therefore a very easy rapport with a large number of people. What he did during his career was to build a large number of facilities. I've listed them here: supersonic tunnels, subsonic tunnels. You know, a huge open circuit tunnel here, 9 feet by 12 feet, a spinning tunnel, and a boundary layer tunnel, in which the work on transition was done. And it continued for many years after that in a variety of different ways. This shows how he picked his research problems. I already mentioned transition on flat plates. It went on to work on cylinders, pipes, base flows, also inspired by that military aircraft problem. Separation bubbles, same thing, wall jets, three-dimensional boundary layers, and so on. And his students wrote theses and wrote papers about it. Here is a list of his students. Now, these students went on to do a variety of other things. It shows here. Some ended up in the United States, these people here. Some ended up in other academic institutions. Some ended up in the space program. One of them ended up at JPL at Caltech, and so on. And many of them actually held high positions. So the effect that he had, both on fluid dynamics research and aerospace in India, was extraordinary. I have a list of his publications here, but I think I mentioned the major ones already. He did not write a lot. After the work on transition, he really wrote very little, except for this paper on a glimpse of fluid mechanics research in Bangalore 25 years ago. Now, that was done on the occasion of the first Asian Congress of Fluid Mechanics, and it tells you about his view of how that research should be done. And basically, he related everything that he did during the institute years to industrial needs. Although many of them developed into full-scale research programs immediately thereafter. I said earlier that he had an extraordinary facility with his hands. His lab was a pleasure because it was so different from other labs in India, almost anywhere else that I've seen, because everything was very carefully designed, very prettily made. At that time, it was very difficult to import equipment from outside, so everything had to be made locally. And in fact, I was reminded of the people who made these things in Bangalore when that Srinivasan showed the picture of G.I. Taylor with Thompson. Dhawan had a few Thompsons. We all had somebody like that to make these things because there was no other way to get these things. It had to be made there. And some of those mechanics were extraordinary. One of them, actually, was, so to speak, well, we had, yeah, one of the things that happened, interestingly, is that David Tritton, one of Townsend's students, came to Bangalore after this work, and he spent 3 years there as a Rutherford fellow. I made measurements in the same tunnel, and they have appeared in JFM as well. But at the end of those 3 years, he got a position in Newcastle to set up a geophysical fluid dynamics laboratory. And he went to these mechanics he had worked with and said, you come with me and set up a lab for me. So one of the mechanics there actually went to spend 4 or 5 years in England setting up that lab. They were extraordinarily skilled, although sometimes unlettered. And their contribution to setting up these facilities was great. Here is one tunnel built by that same man who went to Newcastle to set up the GFD lab there. It's a small tunnel. This is how we were first exposed to shock waves in Bangalore. Sorry, I keep forgetting that I have to look that way. This is how we were exposed to shock waves in Bangalore. It's a 5 millimeter wind tunnel which ran off oxygen tanks taken from an aircraft. There were even Schlieren images, and you saw shock waves and nozzle flows and so on. The other thing he did was to write a book on bird flight. He watched birds a great deal, and once he became chairman of the Indian Space Program, he used to say that when things became too difficult and there were too many problems, he would take time off to watch birds. And he did that over a period of years and wrote a very interesting book on bird flight, especially with an emphasis on Indian birds. Here he is in his director's office. This picture also sort of illustrates his that's his blackboard. He had a blackboard in his director's office. And you can see what he's doing. He's looking at aerodynamics, finite wings, Planters theory, drag curves. Bird there, almost sitting on his head. All these formulas. And here it says, the Space Commission, meeting at 2:30 p.m. And conversion factors on one side. So he combined these different things. That time, an attempt was made in the 1980s through these Asian Congresses of Fluid Mechanics to grow contacts with other Asian countries. And here are two leaders, two doyens, I call them, Satish Dhawan on the left, and Xiaopei Yuan from China, who came to that meeting in Bangalore. And they're sitting there on the lawns of the governor's house where we were all invited for tea. It's interesting that the people who started turbulence research in India and turbulence research in China had some things in common and were otherwise and in other ways were different. Both of them were Caltech graduates, but Dhawan went to aero, Galsit, whereas Zhao went to physics. And Zhao was a theoretician, Dhawan was an experimenter. Nevertheless, they shared many things in common. In both countries, they were marked out for higher national responsibilities. So they were good friends and had met after a long time there in Bangalore and seemed to be very happy to meet each other. Here is the other person from Asia, Professor Tani, who also came to that meeting. And Satish Dhawan is presiding over the lecture that Tani gave on that occasion. So here are parting thoughts about it. So it all happened simultaneously, so to speak. Engineering science, fluid dynamics, and turbulence all started more or less at the same time. It's almost as if turbulence were one way that all of that started. Dhawan was very highly regarded by his students and his colleagues. As I said earlier, looked on problems seemed relevant to India, but went on to become scientific problems in their own right. Ingenious in design, meticulous in execution, cautious in interpretation. That's the message that he tried to convey. And I think in his leadership role, he was the same way. And although it's nothing to do with turbulence directly, I think it's widely recognized in India that Dhawan built the architecture in the space program and made it the finest technology delivery system built either in the public or the private sector in India. But there were these other things. He combined little science and big science effectively. Even when he was running big budgets and major facilities for the country in space, he never forgot little science, and he valued it very highly. He transformed every organization he headed. That included the Indian Institute of Science and the space program. And was a man of great personal charm. Many stories about him, and I could go on telling them, but I will close here. That is Dhawan with his wife in front of the founder's statue at the Indian Institute of Science. Let me just close with one thought. It is one puzzle. As I said, the physics and the mathematics and the chemistry done in India before 1950 was very largely inspired by Britain, what was happening in Britain. Ramanujan had Hardy as his collaborator in Cambridge. J.C. Bose was a man well known in England. But when it came to engineering science and fluid dynamics, it's surprising in retrospect that there was so little inspiration from Britain. I've always wondered why. It started, there were some small investigations in convection, a few papers, one in the 1920s, one in the 1930s, and so on. It came to India through engineering. And it came with contacts between India and Germany on the one side and the United States on the other. Prandtl and his group, Kármán and his colleagues in the two places. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you, interesting talk. Now we have a few minutes of question, comment. Srini, have you? Anything to add? Yes, please.
I was not aware that he had gone to Minnesota before moving to Caltech. That coincides with Don Coles. Were they contemporaries?
Don Coles and Satish were temporaries. But Dhawan was just a few years senior.
Okay.
They knew each other very well.
Yes, please.
There are a lot of historical questions I could ask, but in terms of the fluid mechanics we're talking about, obviously one of the questions that doesn't seem to have been understood very much is the relationship between spots. And of course, there's still a tremendous study of spots with computation at Stanford. I've been involved in that. And the interface of a spot compared with the interface of a jet, a boundary layer, or internal interfaces in turbulence. And I think with the modern computing, we may be able to understand that. I don't know whether there is some work which is done on this on these parallel issues.
Yeah. Well, I was talking chiefly about what Dhawan did and the beginnings of this voyage through turbulence. But yes, there have been some numerical simulations made about spots in India, and I think you're probably familiar with that work. In particular, Joseph Matthew at the Indian Institute of Science has made this calculation. And there are, you made some comments about it. Well, let's see, in the evening lecture you gave, I see that you mentioned the work that Matthew and Basu did. Although they were at that time looking at jets and later on at mixing layers, but Matthew has also done work on the spots. Well, there's been this argument about what the interface is like. And my own view about that is that there will certainly be some kind of a vortex sheet, whatever the edge is. But the simulations that have been done, that were done at that time in Bangalore, were at relatively low Reynolds numbers. And so these sheets were not really sufficiently thin. So it was difficult to be decisive. It was not decisive from my point of view. I myself think that it's possible that these interfaces, well, it's almost certain that these interfaces will have vortex sheets on them. But the question really is the topology. Whether there is a continuous edge or whether they can be deep incursions into the core of the flow. Certainly, the evidence in many shear flows, free shear flows, seems very strong that there are deep incursions into the core of the flow. Although the shape of the lines that determine that incursion may be highly convoluted, fractal, and so on. So I don't see the vortex sheet model as being in conflict with deep incursions from ambient fluid into core of turbulent flows. But that is something else. That is,
that's okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Julien?
Ah, yes.
Yes, since this is obviously the only talk about an Indian scientist, let me also mention the name of Chandrasekhar, who of course is extremely well known, has done major contribution in astrophysics and fluid mechanics, and did some, say, rather interesting attempts to do something about turbulence. And I want to advertise to you, many of you know it already, that Springer has published a few months ago the lectures given by Chandrasekhar in 1955. There was a young student, excuse me, Ed Spiegel at that time, who was taking notes and who published them after many, many years. So it's a rather interesting thing to read.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Is there any question or comment?
No, may I just say one word about Chandrasekhar? Oh. Of course, the work that Chandrasekhar did not have a large influence on the work done in India. But Chandrasekhar made a couple of visits to India at that time, and I remember asking him, this must have been the 1960s, whether he was continuing with his work on turbulence. And his answer was, no, it is too controversial for me. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.